Assalamu alaikum. Hello everyone. Welcome to another ATP video where we will be discussing the topic of gluconeogenesis. In this video, we will discuss the sources and consumption of glucose in our body, as well as explain the process of gluconeogenesis and really dive deep in the matter. Now, before we discuss gluconeogenesis, it's important to understand how glucose is used and obtained, and the significance of hepatic processes that control glucose levels. The brain, red blood cells, kidney medulla, lens, cornea, testes, and exercising muscles need a continuous supply of glucose to remain functional. The liver is responsible for maintaining glucose levels of the blood and to ensure that these organs get the glucose they need. Now, this is achieved by two important processes, glycogenolysis, which is the breakdown of glycogen, and gluconeogenesis, which is the production of new glucose, hence the word neo. And this is our topic for today. The major source of glucose is exogenous glucose, that is, the glucose obtained from food we eat, namely carbohydrates. Dietary galactose and fructose can be converted to glucose in the liver. And now this exogenous supply, it's rapidly used up by the body, lasting something around 4 to 5 hours on average. During fasting, the glucose supply is provided by the breakdown of glycogen in the liver, and this can last somewhere between 10 to 18 hours. Glycogen breakdown drops dramatically after the first 12 hours, during which gluconeogenesis increases. After, say, 24 to 48 hours, gluconeogenesis represents the only source of glucose. During an overnight fast, 90% of glucose production occurs in the liver, while the remaining 10% occurs in the kidneys. However, during a prolonged fast, the kidneys become the major glucose-producing organs. A carbon source is required for the production of glucose to be possible. Important substrates for gluconeogenesis are lactate from anaerobic glycolysis and pyruvate from aerobic glycolysis, glycerol-3-phosphate from the breakdown of triglycerides in adipose tissue, and finally gluconeogenic amino acids from protein breakdown. All amino acids, except leucine and lysine, the two L's, are gluconeogenic amino acids and can therefore be used in gluconeogenesis. Alanine is the major gluconeogenic amino acid. These amino acids are converted to citric acid cycle intermediates, then to malate, following the same path from there to glucose. In humans, it's not really possible to convert fatty acids into glucose, but the only exception to that rule is the odd number carbon fatty acids. So fatty acids with 17 carbons, 15 carbons, you get the picture. And this will yield a small amount of gluconeogenic propionyl-CoA. Now that we've learned the required substrates for gluconeogenesis, we will continue by explaining the sequence of reactions that make up this pathway. So, as we've learned before, glycolysis, the breakdown of glucose, consists of 10 reactions, 7 of which are reversible and 3 of which are irreversible. Now, because of these 3 irreversible reactions, which are, 1, 3, and 10, gluconeogenesis does not simply occur by the reversal of glycolysis. These reactions must be replaced by reactions that favor the production of glucose. Think of these irreversible reactions as obstacles or roadblocks that must be overcome. Now, since we're working backwards, the first roadblock is reaction 10 of glycolysis. The irreversible conversion of phosphoenyl pyruvate to pyruvate by pyruvate kinase. To yield PEP from pyruvate for gluconeogenesis, we need 2 enzymes, pyruvate carboxylase and PEP carboxykinase. The reaction goes as such, pyruvate carboxylase carboxylates pyruvate in the mitochondria to form oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate, a TCA cycle intermediate, cannot pass through the mitochondrial membrane into the cytoplasm. It is reduced to malate, which leaves the mitochondria through the malate shuttle, and enters the cytoplasm where it is reoxidized back to oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate is then decarboxylated and phosphorylated by PEP carboxykinase to form, finally, PEP. PEP is then acted on by the reactions of glycolysis going in the opposite direction until it becomes fructose 1,6-bisphosphate. We've now reached the second roadblock in the pathway, step 3 of glycolysis, also known as the phosphorylation of fructose 6-phosphate into fructose 1,6-bisphosphate, basically just adding another phosphate to the molecule. In glycolysis, this irreversible step is catalyzed by the enzyme phosphofructokinase 1. In gluconeogenesis, phosphofructokinase 1 is replaced by fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase. So you can pretty much guess what this enzyme would do. It'll hydrolyze fructose 1,6 bisphosphate to form fructose 6-phosphate, which is then converted to glucose 6-phosphate by the reversible glycolytic reaction number 2. The final roadblock in this pathway is reaction 1 of glycolysis. Glucose 6-phosphatase replaces hexokinase. Glucose 6-phosphate is transported from the cytosol into the endoplasmic reticulum, where it's hydrolyzed by glucose 6-phosphatase to form free glucose. Now this free glucose, it'll re-enter the cytosol from which it leaves the cell. An important note, glucose 6-phosphatase is a hepatic enzyme, meaning you can only really find it in the liver. The absence of this enzyme from skeletal muscle accounts for the fact that muscle glycogen cannot serve as a source of blood glucose. It's also important to note that once the liver forms glucose through gluconeogenesis, this can't really be used as an energy source for the liver. And with that said, we'll conclude this video about gluconeogenesis. We hope you benefited from this video. Consider liking and subscribing, and as always, thanks for watching.